According to a new memo from Faz Shakir, Bernie Sanders' campaign manager in 2020, Bernie is considering a run for president in 2024 if Biden decides not to run. We're joined now by Ari Rabin-Havt, who is the author of the new book, The Fighting Soul, On the Road with Bernie Sanders. Ari, thank you for joining us today.
Thanks for having
me, guys. Yeah. And so, Ari's been working for Bernie Sanders since, what, 2017?
2017 till July 2021.
Right, and in that period of time, and I've read the book, by the way, it's excellent.
Thank you.
It seems like nobody spent more time with him probably than you.
We had dinner. When we were on the road, we'd have dinner and breakfast and just be in cars together and, you know, probably 1,000 nights on the road in 3 years. Like, and not 1,000, but, you know, hundreds of nights on the road.
And we don't have a ton of time for today's segment. I interviewed you for my podcast at The Intercept Deconstruct, if people want the longer form interview there. But it's a portrait, really, of who Bernie Sanders is rather than kind of a campaign tell-all or a palace.
Yeah, intrigue. I mean, palace intrigue is boring when you don't own the palace.
Mm. Yes. So who cares
at this point? What I did think was Bernie Sanders is one of the most significant historic figures of the 21st century. He is probably one of the most significant figures who has not won the presidency. You know, you think about like William Jennings Bryan, you think about Theodore Roosevelt 1912. And then I think Bernie kind of is in that category of having shifted the Democratic Party.
Maybe Barry Goldwater.
And the Republican Party. I think, but very few people have profiled him in a real way. Like, very few people know who he is, what he's about. And I feel like I had a unique view on history. I had this real privilege of being at his side for 3 years, traveling to 35 states, being with him on picket lines and in restaurants and in cars and on planes. And I wanted to give people that picture because he is such a significant figure in our history.
And I think also sort of mysterious to so many people.
Yeah.
Somebody who was seen as almost a gadfly in Washington for a really long time and then was suddenly thrust to the center of the discourse and had a lot of power, having spent so much time with him in that context of historical significance. How did he absorb the gravity of it? Did he really understand in the moment as all of this was happening exactly what was happening? Is he somebody that like recognizes that power and the gravity of the moment? Or, you know, some people just still are sort of, they're them no matter what.
Well, he's him no matter what.
That's probably
the trick of Bernie. Bernie is Bernie regardless of whether there's a camera, whether there's not.
Right.
But I think he really did absorb what this meant. I think in a lot of ways it was shocking to him, right? Mm-hmm. In his 70s, going from being a kind of senator, but relatively unknown outside a small circle on the left,
right,
to being one of the most famous people in the world, one of the most powerful people in Washington. And in some ways it was a shock. He said to me a few times in the course of this, like, my parents would think it was insane if I told them that I was going to possibly be the Democratic nominee for president of the United States, or even be a senator. That would be crazy coming from where I came from.
Mm-hmm.
And one of the things that gets into his relationship with that power dynamic is this story of the night of his Yemen, you know, war vote. You know, so he successfully passes War Powers Resolution.
Yes.
Works with Republicans.
Yes.
The first one ever in history.
Yes.
That night, he then goes over to Elizabeth Warren's condo for the famous dinner that a year later erupts in the primaries. You know, did he or did he not say?
That's right.
But then the next day, you tell this interesting story about Jonathan Martin, who's in the news for the Kevin McCarthy story, getting wind somehow, probably from the cloakroom, that this dinner had happened, showing up at a Yemen press conference to ask about the condo dinner.
So they had voted. Yeah. So we were in the night before. We were in the cloakroom doing the floor. The floor procedure kind of went into the next day. There was the vote on Yemen. Jonathan Martin, J. Mart, as he's known in D.C., who, like, look, to his credit, he is a dogged reporter, right? And that's what primarily happened here. But Bernie's a guy who he wants to talk about substance and issues. Jonathan Martin caught wind that him and Elizabeth Warren had dinner. Didn't really have an idea what it was about, but everybody kind of was like, oh, this is about the presidential run. He's phone banking Bernie and Elizabeth Warren's staff. We're kind of all a little bit suspect of each other. Like, did you leak that there was a dinner? Did you? And turned out nobody actually did it was some third-party source leak that something happened. So they vote on Yemen, and Bernie, Chris Murphy, Rand Paul, and Mike Lee are kind of going up to the Senate press gallery, which is on the third floor. And they walk up the stairs from the second floor of the Senate to the third floor. And as they get to the top of the stairs, I literally see J-Mart like huffing it up the stairs. Like he's on a mission. He sees his target. He is locked on. He is heading up the stairs.
Ryan Grimm at a Fish concert.
Yeah, basically. He runs up the stairs. They kind of turn into the hallway where the press gallery is. J-Mart like catches up with Bernie. He like has him, there's like this glass wall before you enter the press room that people will know the images of the podium, but there's this like glass wall. They're kind of up against the glass wall. Jonathan Martin's like, what did you say to Elizabeth Warren? Bernie's like, I told her that that 80,000 children a year are dying in Yemen, and that's a shame, which guarantee you that came up during that conversation. Jonathan Martin's like, no, he starts pressing. Bernie's like, you should talk about important things like Yemen, which also he really did mean. Like, he thinks that's a gossipy story, what mm-hmm. Jonathan Martin was doing. Jonathan Martin thinks he's pursuing an important story. They kind of start going at it. Jonathan Martin points out that the New York Times covered Yemen probably more than any other mainstream source, which also, to Jonathan Martin's credit, probably true, actually. New York Times did do substantive Yemen coverage. They're going back and forth. At one point, Mike Lee turns to me, and I still can't tell whether he knew who Jonathan Martin was or didn't, which he turns to me and goes, is that a liberal protester or a conservative protester?
Oh my gosh.
And I go, it's a New York Times reporter. And Mike Lee goes, oh, so liberal.
Yeah.
And which J-Mart isn't, though.
That's fantastic. Yeah,
which at some point, they basically, J-Mart was like, the exchange ends, and J-Mart like is like, doesn't get what he wants, is walking away and just kind of mutters like, asshole at Bernie and walks off. And it's this moment, the thing that it says about Bernie is Bernie thinks that type of political coverage, that type of political reporting is frivolous. What matters? Yemen matters. What matters? Medicare for all matters. What matters? Things that have substance to people's life. And his critique of the media is exactly this moment, that the media is chasing this gossipy story about him and Elizabeth Warren having dinner. Two longtime friends and colleagues at that moment having dinner, not an unusual story, where they should be talking about this really historic achievement where the Senate passes for the first time in history a war powers resolution withdrawing support for a military conflict. And I think it was a real moment of kind of Bernie's critique of the media coming full circle.
Like every human being, there's this duality of Bernie Sanders that plays out in the media in an interesting way, that like the people like Jonathan Martin have this opinion of him as being sort of gruff and hard to work with. And I think as a politician, that's exactly how the media should think of you, and vice versa, that relationship should go in both directions. But he's also seen in this very warm, grandfatherly way by so many, especially young people around the country, just on a personal level, as somebody who spent so much time with him. Can you speak to that? Because it really does seem to be both. And I think it's good that he's sort of gruff to people in the establishment. But at the same time, it is interesting to me that he comes across so warmly.
Well, here's the thing. He is a warm grandfather.
Right.
Like, I think that's the thing most people never see about Bernie, is with his grandkids, he is like a completely different human being than you'd see in the Jonathan Martin exchange. He is this warm grandfatherly figure who just wants to like go in the backyard and hit baseballs and kick soccer balls and be with his grandkids. But he does have a real critique of politics. He doesn't think this is a game. He thinks this is important. He thinks the things he is doing matter in people's lives. And he thinks the frivolous nature of that distracts from the ability to talk about those things. And I think reporters get frustrated, first off, I think with Bernie, that he is the most on-message politician
Very ever. Frustrating.
That he doesn't break, right? There was the time that Ali G kind of got the interview with Bernie. Yeah. But the thing about that interview was he just doesn't break, right? You can be completely like going at him in a joking manner, and he will not change. Right? And I think that's frustrating the reporters. I think it's frustrating the reporters that...
And other members of Congress.
Well, I think other members of Congress, I don't think it's frustrating towards. I think they kind of have to confront the fact that this is somebody who's not going to right. glad hand and schmooze. Right. I think for reporters, it's frustrating because for your job, you want the color, you want the that, and he's not going to give it to you.
Mm-hmm. Ari, thanks so much for coming by. So the book, again, it's on sale April 26th.
April 26th, Tuesday.
The Fighting Soul
but
on
you
the
can
road.
Pre-order.
On the road with Bernie Sanders.
And you took this picture.
Yes, I did take that picture.
And this is Jesse Jackson just off camera here. This is a really profound moment. Jesse Jackson's campaign really shaped
Bernie Sanders, brought him
into the Democratic fold.
Yeah.
And Ari, you photograph sharks now.
I do. It's a fun hobby.
check out Ari at sharks on Instagram.
Also at Ari Rabin-Havt
at
on Instagram.
Ari Rabin-Havt as well. Anyway, congratulations.
Thank you, Ryan. Thank you.
We will have more Rising right after this.